Natalie Barlow got it for me like a long time ago because I didn't have access to it. So a lot of it's going to be pictures and tables and things like that that we'll talk through to kind of help you guys go through that. So the objectives of this lecture are to outline hyperthyroidism, including pathophysiology, clinical presentation, and laboratory assessment. Evaluate how to diagnose hyperthyroidism based on clinical picture, radioactive iodine uptake tests, and thyroid scans. Determine treatment options for hyperthyroid patients. Recognize how to appropriately manage patients who are pregnant. So we have a little part in there about pregnancy. And then briefly discuss thyroid storm. A little bit about prevalence and impact. So there are more than 12% of the U.S. population that develop a thyroid condition during their lifetime. An estimated 20 million Americans have some form of thyroid disease. However, 60% of these patients are completely unaware that they have any type of thyroid disease. So as you can see, that's a large percentage. So it's good in terms of you guys to keep on, you know, the lookout for it. Again, unfortunately, for us women, 5 to 8 times more likely in females to have thyroid problems than males. And as we talked about earlier, I think in one of Dr. Atkinson's lectures about AFib, patients who have long-standing untreated hyperthyroidism, 10 to 15% will develop AFib, and 5 to 6% will develop heart failure. So it's very important in these patients to actually try to diagnose the thyroid issue so you can prevent these other complications from happening. Just to talk a little bit about normal thyroid function, it is a negative feedback loop. So your hypothalamus releases thyrotropin-releasing hormone, or TRH, that stimulates the anterior pituitary. From the anterior pituitary, there's a release of TSH, or thyroid-stimulating hormone, that then goes on to bind to thyroid cells. Iodine is then imported into the thyroid cells by a transporter, and that is what helps convert, into T4 and T3. So in order to make T4 and T3, you do have to have the iodine. So it is important in a lot of places to have an iodine-rich diet. So that's something to keep in mind too. Then from there, the thyroid releases T4 and T3. Like I said, this is a negative feedback loop, so the T4 and T3 then go back and negatively inhibit, saying, you know, there's enough of us, you don't have to continue making more T4 and T3. And then in the periphery, T4 is converted to T3, so that's something that's important to know as well. Also in the periphery, T4 and T3 are highly protein-bound molecules, so they bind, more than 99% of both of them are bound to thyroid binding globulin, which has a high affinity for both T4 and T3. So, you know, when you talk about getting levels, you talk about a free T4 versus a total, and that's the reason, because a lot of it is actually bound to a protein. So hyperthyroidism, the definition is overactive thyroid leading to the overproduction of thyroid hormone. Incidence, it affects approximately 2% of women and 0.2% of men, with the most common cause being Graves' disease, and I'll talk some more about causes in a later slide. So what are common, I know we talked about hypothyroidism, but what do you see like clinically when a patient comes in and they are, you know, you suspect hyperthyroidism? So some of the same things that you might see with hypothyroidism.
Oh, I was just going to say, let them go ahead. The thing that kind of freaks me out on hyperthyroidism is I'm in line at some sporting event, and the lady sitting behind me is like, and I find myself, you know, I'm in this struggle of like, do I say something?
I've been there.
You know, I mean, has anyone else been there? You know what I'm talking about?
This is the picture that Dr. Lawrence had on the sheet as well, and obviously this is just the hyperthyroidism part of it, but I thought that was kind of a neat graphic because it also has hypothyroidism on the one that
looks like we coordinated.
I know. So I think the interesting thing about both hypo and hyperthyroidism and with your thyroid function, it obviously does so much stuff in terms of thyroid hormone. So there are a lot of different things that thyroid hormone helps regulate within the body. So you can see a very wide variety of signs and symptoms in both hypo and hyperthyroidism. So sometimes I can understand why there is such a large percentage of patients that are undiagnosed with thyroid issues. this lovely table is to kind of go through the most common causes and what their actual mechanism is. So I think it's kind of helpful to see the different types, but pretty much just focusing on the most common causes, which are the top three. So first, most common cause is Graves' disease, which is an autoimmune process in which antibodies stimulate the TSH receptor, leading to overproduction of thyroid hormone. So this actually is an autoimmune process. The other two include toxic adenoma or Plummer disease, where somatic mutation in TSH receptor or a GF-alpha gene in the thyroid nodule leads to overstimulation as well. And then finally, the toxic multinodular goiter, which is where expansion of collagenic cells with an activating TSH receptor mutation, once again, you're getting that overstimulation. So those are the most common. And then I also listed less common causes and rare causes, just so that way you guys had that information with the mechanism, because sometimes it's nice to see that. So clinically, these patients present, as I said, in terms of signs and symptoms, you're going to see sort of a wide variety of things. However, the most common is going to be your adrenergic symptoms. In patients who have elevated thyroid hormone, there is an amplification of catecholamine signaling through increased numbers of cell surface beta adrenergic receptors. So that's how you're going to see. I don't know that the mechanism is completely understood in how that happens, like how there is that upregulation of beta receptors, but this ultimately results in that adrenergic stimulation. So a lot of the most common symptoms that you're going to see are going to be the palpitation, the tachycardia, the anxiety, tremor, jitteriness, heat intolerance, lid lag, such like that. And then, like Dr. Hayden said earlier, you can also have things such as the exophthalmos, in Graves' disease, there's things such as thyroid acupatchy, which I'll show you a picture of that too, so the clubbing of the fingers, weight loss, like Sarah said. So there are a lot of different things that you can see clinically presenting in these patients who come in with hyperthyroidism. I don't know if you guys have anything else to add that we see patients with, but. So I just put a couple of pictures. Obviously, the wide eye that Dr. Higdon talked about. So the top one is the exophthalmos that you see in patients. The top right picture is Plummer nail, where the nail separates from the bed distally, as you can see in kind of those middle fingers there. And then the bottom left picture is the thyroacupatchy, where it's the clubbing of the fingers and sometimes the toes and then swelling of the soft tissue. So I don't know whether that's exaggerated picture, because they look pretty large to me, but that's kind of crazy. And then the lid lag, I thought this was a pretty good picture, just trying to show what the normal would look like versus the lid lag that you can get in hyperthyroidism. So just a couple of pictures for you to kind of see actual examples.
Yeah, that lid lag, when you're doing it with a patient and you're asking them to follow your finger and then come down, it's almost like you're having to pull the shade back down to where it should be. You know, the pupil and the iris come back down to the normal location, and then it's just ever so subtle, the lid being behind. I've seen it one true time in my life, but it was dramatic. You know, it was a pregnant patient, and she definitely had it. But it's pretty neat. If anybody would love to see it, so.
So this slide, once again, is from the guidelines, and it's just pretty much how you would go about working up a patient who has hyperthyroidism. So initially, you have those signs or symptoms of hyperthyroidism. Then you would go ahead and order, you know, your thyroid function test to see where they are on that spectrum. So TSH, free T4, T3 levels. And then after that, depending on what you're suspecting, you would go ahead and get a radioactive iodine uptake and then a scan of the thyroid, which I'll continue to talk about as we go on. But pretty much you would just sort of follow this down, and that sort of gives you, depending on what you get on these tests, we'll say, okay, this is most likely Graves' disease, this is more than likely toxic multinodular goiter, or toxic adenoma. So that's kind of helpful in terms of how it breaks it down. Lab values. Dr. Lawrence already talked about the thyroid TSH normal value. So normal is 0.5 to 4.7, but obviously it depends on where you are with your lab reference range, but that's a basic range in terms of what's normal. With T4 and T3, as I said, you would have probably most of the time you get a free T4 versus the one that's like a total. So those are this is more just for your reference to have in terms of what the normal ranges are. So in terms of hyperthyroidism, what would the thyroid function test look like with TSH, T3, T4? What would you expect them to come back as if they're hyper?
TSH is low.
Free T4 is elevated.
Yes. So pretty much just with the overt hyperthyroidism, your TSH is going to be suppressed because if you think about that negative feedback loop that we talked about, you're overproducing T3 and T4 in hyperthyroidism, so you're negatively feeding back saying don't produce any more TSH. And therefore, you're going to have a lower TSH level versus your T4 and T3 levels are going to be elevated. Then this diagram, which also shows kind of others, things that can cause sort of those symptoms and gives you reference ranges. So in these other conditions, you can see changes in TSH and T4, T3, but pretty much with hyperthyroidism, that's what you're looking at. So going on to the diagnostics. The radioactive iodine uptake test can help determine the cause specifically, and what it is it's the percentage of iodine-123 tracer dose that's actually taken up by the thyroid gland during a 24-hour period, which usually in a normal thyroid would be about 15 to 25%. In thyroiditis, or just inflammation of the thyroid, it would be very low, so 0 to 2%. And then in Graves' disease, toxic adenoma, toxic multinodular goiter, uptake is really high, so you'll see that uptake be more than the 15 to 25%. After you do the radioactive iodine uptake test, you then would do a thyroid scan to actually see where the distribution of that radioactive iodine is within the thyroid. So a homogeneous distribution actually indicates more of a Graves' disease. Accumulation in one area can lead towards the toxic adenoma, and then other examples can be, you know, in pregnancy and lactation, or amiodarone can actually induce thyrotoxicosis, so that's important to note too. And then if there are multiple spots of accumulation, you can have, that leads you more towards a toxic multinodular goiter, which makes sense because it's multinodular. The little table at the bottom just sort of says all of this, but in kind of a more condensed form, so for your reference as well. So I thought these were good pictures to sort of show you, and it's the same thing in both of them. So A is what your normal thyroid would look like in both cases. So you're going to have, you know, a normal uptake, that 15 to 25%. B is your Graves' disease, where you have that homogeneous uptake of the radioactive iodine. So as you can see, it's kind of all throughout the entire thyroid. C is your toxic multinodular goiter, which is where you're going to see multiple different areas where the radioactive iodine is taken up. Multinodular, that makes sense. D is your toxic adenoma, so there's going to be one kind of dense area where you see that radioactive iodine. And then the last one is just in thyroiditis, where you can see that there is lower uptake, so in inflammation, the thyroid takes up less iodine. So it's just kind of neat to be able to see the picture of it. So I know it's on the sheet, but what are the treatment options that you normally think of when you have hyperthyroid? Like what you would see patients on?
Radioactive iodine ablation, mm-hmm. Surgery.
So that covers the major ones. So beta blockers actually are used to help control the adrenergic system. So as I said, the adrenergic signs that you're going to see with these patients are usually the most common symptom that you see. So you want to put them on a beta blocker to try to help stop that those side effects from happening. So most patients will be on a beta blocker. Then after that, it's kind of a combination of things. So you can put patients on antithyroid medications, which are your PTU and your methimazole. Radioactive iodine ablation is also an option, and then surgical thyroidectomy is also an option as well. So just to go through the different options, beta blockers competitively block response to beta-1 and beta-2 adrenergic stimulation, which makes sense, they're beta blockers. Propranolol has a theoretical advantage of inhibiting 5-monoiodinase resulting in blocking of the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. I don't know whether there's too much information on that out there, but that's also why a lot of times when patients are put on beta blockers and have hyperthyroidism, you'll see them be placed on propranolol for that possible advantage. The table just pretty much gives you the beta blockers that are most commonly seen, the dosage, any adverse effects. Propranolol is a non-selective beta blocker, so you hit both the beta 1 and the beta 2 adrenergic receptors. And then costs I put on here, I did try to look it up. It looks like propranolol and etranolol are on the $4 list at Walmart, so that is kind of important in terms of looking at your patients, you know, what they can actually afford, because as you go along, PTU and Methimazole are not always so expensive. So antithyroid medications, the group is called thionamides.
Yeah. Do you mind if I ask for a discussion?
Yeah.
So for the symptomatic medications, do we ever start them on that while they're waiting to get in with their specialist type of thing? Because we probably not going to give them ablation and then surgery, but do
absolutely.
We usually start them on the symptomatic control?
I don't usually hesitate if their symptoms are very severe, but I can't say that. I've only faced that a couple of times. The pregnant girl that I talked to you about that had the lid lag, I started it on the screen.
Okay, so the two options are PTU and then methimazole, and this is once again just a reference slide. So normal dosage, the mechanism of action of both. They both inhibit synthesis of thyroid hormone, but the one thing is that PTU, once again, is hypothesized to have that blocking in the periphery of conversion to T4 to T3. So sometimes you're not only just hitting the thyroid, but you're also hitting the peripheral hormones that are already, you know, in the system. And then in terms of adverse effects that you see, with PTU, it is the drug of choice in the first trimester of pregnancy, but it does carry a higher risk of liver failure than methimazole. So that's why going forward in pregnancy, usually methimazole is what is preferred except in the first trimester. So first trimester, you want patients to be on PTU. Furthermore, you would want them to be on methimazole because of that risk of liver failure. The cost is more of a, I got these off of Lexicomp, so they're kind of like the wholesale cost, like that's what be able to get them for. So I don't know in terms of what insurance would pay for and things like that, so it might not necessarily be that expensive for certain patients. And then with these, a lot of times they serve as long-term therapy, or you can use them as bridge therapy until you end up doing a radioactive iodine ablation or a thyroidectomy. So these are seen in a decent amount in patients who have hyperthyroidism. Remission actually occurs in about 30% of patients with Graves' disease when they're treated with these medications, so that is something to kind of note. That's a decent number of patients. And then a lot of times, patients would be placed on these and then move on to the radioactive iodine or the thyroidectomy if they don't remain or end up going into remission. How do we monitor these antithyroid medications? You would want to get a baseline CBC with differential and hepatic panel should be obtained prior to starting PTU or methimazole. Free T4 and total T3 should be obtained 4 weeks after starting either of those medications and every 4 to 8 weeks thereafter to adjust dosages. And then once levels normalize, you would monitor thyroid function tests about every 3 months. These medications should be continued for about 12 to 18 months and then tapered or discontinued if the TSH levels are normal. As I said, you know, a lot of times patients can achieve remission using these medications, but if discontinued, there is a high relapse rate. Somewhere between 30 and 70% of patients actually have a relapse when you do take patients off of these medications. So it's kind of weighing the risks and benefits, and a lot of times that's within the first year after you stop the medications. If discontinued, thyroid function tests should be monitored probably about every 1 to 3 months for 6 to 12 months. I don't know whether you guys do it differently. And then from what I saw when I was looking, elevated or above normal TSH levels greater than 4 at the time when you discontinue antithyroid medications are associated with an increased risk of permanent remission. So I don't know exactly how that completely equates to it, but they were just saying that a lot of what they saw was if the levels were on the higher end of normal when you discontinued the antithyroid meds, then they had a better chance of remission. So just something to keep in mind if you're looking at a patient. So I don't know if you guys do exactly like this in the clinic, but.
So we do monitor every 3 months. We watch pretty closely, and then I always watch for at least yearly labs thereafter. I haven't been practicing that long, but at least yearly to make sure it's not recurring.
Yeah.
Yeah, so good.
Especially since the relapse rate is so high. Next, radioactive iodine. So this is the most common treatment that you see for Graves' disease in the U.S. It is contraindicated in pregnancy and lactation, so you want to avoid, and you even want to avoid getting pregnant like 6 months around when you actually have the radioactive iodine ablation. So it's important to, you know, educate patients on that, that they don't want to be getting pregnant in that time frame. There is a relative contraindication in patients with severe Graves' orbitopathy because radioactive iodine can actually exacerbate eye disease, so that's important to think about too. You want to discontinue the antithyroid meds at least 5 days prior, but they can be restarted 3 to 5 days after in order to maintain thyroid function. So if you think about it, when you do the radioactive iodine ablation, you can have a surge of thyroid function afterwards, and that can put patients at risk for having things such as thyroid storm or like that. So you want to give them the antithyroid medication so that way you don't end up having that type of that reaction afterwards. As I said, it can take up to 12 weeks to achieve full effect of radioactive iodine ablation, so that's why you want to put them on the antithyroid medications. Ablation causes patients to become permanently hypothyroid, so it does require you to then put them on the thyroid hormone supplementation, so your Synthroid. In terms of monitoring, you want to monitor free T4 and total T3 measurements 4 to 8 weeks after the ablation. If patients are still hyperthyroid at this time, you continue to monitor free T4 and T3 every 4 to 6 weeks until they reach that point. Start thyroid hormone replacement when patient's labs start showing that hypothyroidism sign. And then finally, the surgical thyroidectomy. This is preferred in patients with goiter-induced compressive symptoms and those with contraindications to radioactive iodine ablation or antithyroid meds, or, you know, if it's an emergent situation, a lot of times they'll take patients for the surgical thyroidectomy. It is surgery, so obviously there are risks that go along with surgery, such as injury to the parathyroid glands or injury to the laryngeal nerve, so you have to kind of take that into account too.
Can I add some? Go ahead. I'm going to see what your next slide.
It's just adjunct treatments. You can go ahead.
So, what would be your indication that injury had happened to the parathyroid glands? This is a great old question. There's one lab that would definitely, which would it be high or would it be low? I was correct. So you have how many parathyroid glands usually?
Four.
One of the most variable glands in the body for where it lies around the thyroid. Right? So you would think that with thyroidectomy that we would injure them all the time, but the reality is an experienced surgeon, about 95-96% of the time, they get in and get out without damaging the parathyroid gland. So it is something to think about, though, because I've had several patients that have thyroidectomy that have checked the calcium, and the implications of that is that without calcium supplementation, you can have premature osteoporosis.
These are a little bit just extra information for you guys. So adjunct treatments in patients with hyperthyroidism, cholestyramine is a bile acid sequestrant that binds thyroid hormones in the intestines, and then you end up excreting them. And obviously the adverse effects are there. So in patients who you're having a hard time controlling, you can try to add this on. Obviously, since it is a bile acid sequestrant and stays in the intestines, you also have to worry about drug-drug interactions with this, because you can have those. And then SSKI, or supersaturated potassium iodide, this is, you do, it's like the dose of just 5 drops every 8 hours, so that's kind of interesting. It inhibits secretion of thyroid hormone, blocks the uptake of radioactive iodine. However, it may aggravate hypothyroidism if given before antithyroid treatment, so you have to give at least 1 hour after methimazole or PTU. Don't give before the radioactive iodine treatment. So, in terms of, because obviously this has iodine in it, and like I said, you need an iodine-rich diet in order to make T4 and T3, so that's why they suggest not actually giving this before, because you can actually have a flare of that hyperthyroidism. So it's just something to kind of know. So now we're going to go into pregnancy. Effects of pregnancy on thyroid hormones include estrogen-mediated increase in thyroid-binding globulin, which is the globulin that binds to T4 and T3 in the periphery. Increased volume of distribution, which we know because they're pregnant, and then placental metabolism and transport of maternal thyroxine. So all of these changes occur and lead to a 20 to 40% increase in thyroid hormone requirement as early as the 4th week of gestation in patients who are pregnant. So it's really important to screen pregnant patients, and these are pretty much what they list as what you would be looking for in a pregnant patient, indications for doing the thyroid testing. So if the patient is currently on a thyroid therapy, family history of autoimmune thyroid disease, a goiter, history of autoimmune disorder, high dose neck radiation, and then history of postpartum thyroid dysfunction, previous delivery of infant with thyroid disease, therapy for hyperthyroidism, or type 1 diabetes. So all of these put patients at risk, and you would want to test them if they were pregnant for thyroid disease. And this is just thyroid disease in general, so this is not necessarily hyperthyroidism. So I thought this table was really neat in terms of looking at what pregnancy can do to the different thyroid hormones, what you see. So it gives you the non-pregnant levels, the first trimester levels, second trimester, and third trimester, and I'm not going to go into all of it, but pretty much it's interesting to see that throughout pregnancy there are a ton of changes that occur in terms of thyroid hormone to all of them. So T4, T3, the levels change, and then same thing with your, like I said, the thyroxine binding globulin, so, and TSH. So this is just more for reference to see, okay, if my patient's in the first trimester reference range, what am I sort of looking at? Where should they be in terms of their thyroid function? Now to specifically go into hyperthyroidism from pregnancy, it is less common than hypothyroidism, with the incidence of about 0.2% during pregnancy. And this little table here talks about the effects associated with thyroid disease in pregnancy. So preconception, if the patients have past hyperthyroidism, you can have congenital malformations that occur. During pregnancy, you can have problems such as heart failure, placental abruption, preeclampsia, preterm delivery, and then the baby can also be affected. So the baby can have things such as a goiter, intrauterine growth restrictions, small for the gestational age, silver, and have issues with thyroid dysfunction as well. And medications, so you also have to think, like we said, you know, in patients who are on these medications, they're not exactly benign in terms of pregnancy. So PTU can lead to maternal liver failure, and that's why it's only suggested in the first trimester of pregnancy. But methimazole also has possible adverse effects as well, so it's important to note those. Treatment of hyperthyroidism in pregnancy, we pretty much already talked about this. So methimazole is preferred agent after the first trimester. I put the dosage there, and then PTU is usually in the first trimester. Your treatment goal is to have serum-free T4 in the upper one-third of the normal range for patients who are pregnant, and then measuring of serum TSH and free T4 every 2 weeks until on a stable medication dose. So if you actually do have to start them on medication, you really want to follow the patient closely to make sure that they're actually reaching an appropriate T4 level so that way you don't have any of those adverse effects that you see. Women with Graves' disease should have a thyroid receptor antibody measured at the end of the second trimester. That's something that they suggested in the guidelines, so I think it's just to make sure that, you know, with the Graves' disease, that they're also not having other issues. And then in women at high risk, which were in the list that was on one of the previous slides that I read to you, the little table, fetal ultrasonography should be performed monthly after 20 weeks gestation to detect evidence of fetal thyroid dysfunction. So just to make sure that there isn't anything passing on to the baby. So postpartum thyroid dysfunction, actually patients who, you know, after having a baby can have hyperthyroidism as well. So the incidence can range from 1.1 to 21.1% of women, so that's a decently large range. Postpartum, and this is just inflammation of the thyroid, not necessarily, well, this one is. So postpartum thyroiditis is defined as abnormal TSH levels within the first 12 months of postpartum. So you are looking at your TSH levels at that point. Clinical course is mixed in patients, so pretty much you don't know exactly what you're going to see in these patients. 25% present with symptoms of hyperthyroidism, followed by hypothyroidism, and then recover. 43% present with symptoms of hypothyroidism, and then 32% present with symptoms of hyperthyroidism. So it's really hard to kind of diagnose it in these patients, exactly what they're going to have after they have.
And what else clinically might you think that they have? Sorry, you got a lady who's presenting, feeling out of control, feeling emotional, feeling tired or anxious. So don't diagnose postpartum depression without checking thyroid, please. Sorry. I've seen patients come in who've been put on SSRIs, which are great for postpartum depression, but they're not going to treat the postpartum thyroiditis.
Yeah.
And you check the labs, you're like, great, that's why it's not working, because you weren't given the right diagnosis.
So radioactive iodine uptake scan can be used to differentiate between Graves' disease and postpartum thyroiditis, because like I said, you would see a different picture on the actual thyroid scan. However, in patients who are breastfeeding, it is contraindicated, like I said earlier, so that kind of leaves you at a little bit of a hard spot. In terms of treatment, once again, it's hard because it depends on what type of phase the patient is in when they're postpartum. So if they're in the hyperthyroid phase, it is caused by an autoimmune destruction of the thyroid, which results in release of stored thyroid hormone. Therefore, antithyroid medications are typically not beneficial because what's happening is if you're not trying to stop the thyroid, it's that the thyroid is basically being torn apart by the antibodies, and therefore the antithyroid hormone or medications are not going to benefit in that case. It is important to differentiate between Graves' disease and the hyperthyroid phase because Graves requires antithyroid medication. So, weirdly, because Graves' disease is an autoimmune, but you still use PTU and methimazole for Graves' disease. So, that's why you want to try to do the radioactive iodine test if you can. And then, once again, the symptomatic treatment of beta blockers.
Well, I think Graves' disease is like an antibody that activates the receptor.
It does, yeah.
Whereas the thyroiditis is like,
and I guess in that case, it's talking about the destruction of the thyroid versus like the activation of the thyroid. So that does make sense.
And both medications, methimazole or PTU, although we use methimazole more, are okay for breastfeeding.
Okay.
Just FYI. They're both L2.
So in terms of monitoring for patients who are postpartum, those listed on the previous slide, women with a history of type 1 diabetes, and then women with thyroglobulin or, well, thyroperoxidase autoantibodies. So in the previous slide, I talked about like kind of who's at risk for these. So these are the women that you're looking at in terms of wanting to monitor them postpartum. If they're asymptomatic but they're at risk, you can screen them at 3 and 6 months postpartum using serum TSH measurements. And then women with a history of postpartum thyroiditis, so previously this has happened to them, they're in an increased risk of permanent hypothyroidism and should be screened annually thereafter. So it's important to look at these patients, you know, like Dr. Lauren said, regularly to make sure that this doesn't actually continue to occur. So very quickly and briefly, thyroid storm. It was first described in 1926 as the crisis of exophthalmic goiter, which I think is interesting. It is an emergent situation, and it's not very much is understood about thyroid storms, so there's a lot that's still trying to be defined about the disease state in general. There are a lot of different things that can cause thyroid storm, including thyroid surgery, incompletely treated hyperthyroidism or an interruption of treatment, major trauma, infection, iodine exposure from radiocontrast dyes, which is interesting because, you know, a lot of times patients will come into the ED and end up getting like a CT home to rule out, you know, PE or things like that. I actually had a patient who came in and got that and ended up going into thyroid storm and was there for a very, very long time, ended up having to have an LVAD, and like her heart basically failed. So it's definitely emergent and can happen pretty quickly. And then 25 to 45% of patients have no known precipitating factors. So, you know, they might come in and present and you're saying, I think this is thyroid storm, but I don't see anything that I think would have caused it. It still could be thyroid storm. So this is the Birch-Bertofsky point scale. I don't know whether any of you guys have ever seen this before. It's not actually necessarily validated, but this is what a lot of places use to, as sort of a point scale to see what the likelihood of them actually having thyroid storm is. And it just takes into account sort of different clinical signs that you would see when they come in. So their temperature, tachycardia, whether they had AFib on presentation, congestive heart failure, and then GI or gastrointestinal hepatic dysfunction, what you can see there, and then central nervous system disturbances, and then if they've ever had thyroid storm before, so that's what the precipitant history is. And what you would do is pretty much rate the patient, and then the bottom portion there gives you your point scale, so whether you're actually really worried about thyroid storm or not. So for example, the patient that I had who came in and got ended up in thyroid storm, ended up scoring on this scale, I think, close to the upper 80s. So she definitely was pretty likely to have thyroid storm. So I just think this is a pretty neat scale because you can do this pretty quickly just looking at the clinical symptoms that you would have when the patient is brought in. I don't know whether you guys have ever seen this before.
I haven't. Have you used this before?
I've never seen the chart. And the only time I ever even thought about thyroid storm ever was when I was on the general surgery rotation. And we would mention it every time that we do a thyroidectomy. I won't be honest. it's okay, we got to check for the blood pressure. If the temperature of this patient goes through the roof or their heart rate goes through the roof, I need to know that. So. Usually the next day when you go in to remove the dressing, which you can't believe you're doing one day after you just had their neck cut wide open, that's what you would check for. So.
Yeah, and obviously this is an emergent situation. These patients are pretty sick, so when they would most likely present to the ED, or at least that's what I've seen. So, I mean, I know you guys are rotating through there, but in terms of like practice here, I don't know that you would have people coming in that are in thyroid storm. But just for reference, it's a cool chart. In terms of treatment, treatment should be initiated immediately, so as soon as you suspect that the patient has thyroid storm. And pretty much it's a combination of a bunch of different treatments, so pretty much everything that you can throw at them for hyperthyroid. So it should target all aspects of thyroid hormone, so synthesis, release of thyroid hormone, and attempt to minimize effects of circulating hormone. So you're kind of trying to cover the entire gamut to stop the thyroid storm. As I said, it's a multimodal treatment strategy, so you pretty much throw everything. Beta blockers, anti-thyroid drug therapy, SSKI, a lot of times they're on corticosteroid therapy. In severe cases, you can do aggressive cooling and have volume resuscitation and then respiratory support. A lot of these patients end up having like the AFib or heart failure issues along with thyroid storm. So like I said, a lot of times they'll need that support as well. And the goal of the treatment is to reverse thyroid storm before the patient ends up progressing to that multi-organ failure. So it's pretty important to get these medications on as quickly as you can. And that's all that I have for hyperthyroid. So pretty basic in terms of how you treat it and what you look at. The guidelines are really good. I like them a lot in terms of the American Academy of Anesthesiologists. So,
I have a question. So, I feel like this is always something I get confused on boards between subacute thyroiditis, postpartum thyroiditis, and then thyroid storm. And one of the clues is always like a tender or non-tender thyroid. So, which ones is a tender?
I'm not sure.
Use the beta blockers just to make them comfortable. But if you start the PTU, does that mess up the thyroid scan uptake?
That's a good question. I know that PTU and methimazole are supposed to affect like how your thyroid actually, you know, spits out thyroid hormone. I don't know that I ever read anything about it affecting the radioactive iodine scan. So I'm not sure about that. I've never seen anything about it, but I think a lot of times, at least from when I was looking at this, they do the radioactive iodine scan before they would actually start it, so.
Yeah. It'll take a while to get your labs back, and then you just schedule that, so then there could be a week or two before.
I guess if you actually, if you clinically suspect it, even without the labs, I'm sure you would want to start them on something.
Yeah. Sure, the beta blockers are the safest.
So evidently, I was let down somewhere in my 20 years of education because subacute thyroiditis is the tender thyroid. You can extend up into your ears.
Also called the weird thyroiditis.
So
those are synonymous.
So you get the crown for the day. Yeah.
So what I'm looking at with the subacute thyroiditis and the queer vein thyroiditis is it's moderate to severe thyroid pain, tenderness, it can be migratory, and affect different areas of the gland at different times. There, the subacute thyroiditis has three phases. There's a triphasic course of transient thyrotoxicosis, that's when they're tender, followed by hypothyroidism, and then return to euthyroid. But during the thyrotoxic stage, you have tenderness of your thyroid. I was let down in my training too.
And is that the one that's like post-viral?
Self-limited inflammation. It can last a few weeks to many months.
Okay, back. I think this was actually one of your first slides.
Yeah, it comes after the flu and mumps.
It's a viral-like illness.
The causes? Which one?
Etiology is presumed to be viral.
Subacute.
And it tends to occur after an upper respiratory infection.
That's the thing.
Okay. Look at that.
There you go.
Great lecture.
Hadden didn't even know it.
This is wonderful. We had it in there. Any board's questions? You guys up for it? Okay. Let's see how you're feeling. So, do you mind?
Yeah.
25-year-old female who's 3 months postpartum presents with multiple complaints, including increasing weakness and fatigue, intolerance to warm environments, awake.